Hello everyone, this is Khushbu and today I will be dealing with the General Clauses Act. To give you a brief, this act has been asked in the intermediate exam for around 10 marks. The act itself is quite small, pretty simple to understand. Pretty simple questions are asked, like the questions are quite repetitive, honestly. And if you do it well, you will be able to easily score those 10 marks. I will be quickly running through the act. And I'll be dealing with sections which are important, which have been asked time and again, which have been covered in your MTP, RTP, which has come in your exams. I've also listed down some other sections which are there in the Act, which is nice to read because sometimes you may get an MCQ in that regard, which you may have to answer. And if you just go through my notes, it will be easier for you to answer. Just to help you, what I've done is I have written down the exam in which that question is asked. So when you're studying, it will be quite easy if you could just go through the notes and see when it's asked and where it's asked, and then accordingly you can determine the importance. So the General Clauses Act, as it's mentioned, is it's a generic act. So you have the Indian Contract Act, you have the Companies Act, which deals with companies, you have the Negotiable Instruments Act, which deals with negotiable instruments. This is a General Clauses Act, which deals with the generic things. It deals with definitions which are not provided in the specific act. It deals with general terminology which is not given in the specific act. So it's basically helping you to not repeat the same things again and again in the same act, and just saves your time. It shortens the language of the specific act and provides general provision which is applicable everywhere. So that is the objective. The act has come into force on 11th of March 1897. And the object of the act is to shorten the language of the Central Act. So it applies only to the Central Act. It does not apply to the state laws. But you will notice that the state laws are in sync with the Central Act. So they can't go against it. So though it's applicable only to the Central Act, the state laws are in sync with the General Clauses Act. And it provides uniformity of expression. So just to give you an example, in most of the acts, if you see, then it would be mentioned that he would be doing this or he would be liable to. Like, a masculine gender is used everywhere. You will not find a single act where they would have used a feminine gender. So the General Clauses Act clarifies that when a masculine gender is used, it also means to include the feminine gender. And that is like a pretty generic thing, which is given in this act, but you will never find it in any other act, be it Income Tax, Companies Act. It's not clarified, but then a female can never come and say, okay, this is not applicable to me because this uses he and it doesn't use she. Because in the General Clauses Act, it says it applies, even though the words he is used, it will apply to both male and female. So that is the way it provides uniformity of expression in the Central Acts. It helps to avoid repetition of the same words. So everywhere I'm not saying acha he used kiya, it will apply to she also. It's just given in one act, it's applicable everywhere. And it avoids superfluity of language in the statute. Now there is a Supreme Court case law in this regard, which is nice to remember. If you don't remember, it's fine. It's okay if you don't mention cases in the exam. Now if you see most of the acts, every act would start with a clause saying that, you know, this act is applicable to so-and-so area except for so-and-so area. But in the General Clauses Act, there is nothing given as to the territorial extent to which the General Clauses Act is applicable. And the reason being that General Clauses Act is per se not defining anything. It's a generic act which is to assist the other acts which are there. So it will be applicable to the acts. So the territorial extent will depend on, when it's applicable to the Indian Contract Act, then it will depend on to the territory to which the Indian Contract Act is applicable. So there's no territorial extent given in the General Clauses Act. It will be applicable to the territory to which the Central Act is applicable. Just one important thing that you may notice that if the GLC is not applicable, the court may apply the general principles of GLC just to get a better understanding of the Act. Now, there are some basics of legislation which I'll be going through. One is the preamble. So, preamble is given at the beginning of the Act. It gives you the idea as to why an Act is coming, the intention of the Act as to why it's come into force. It is there to aid the Act, but most of the provisions in the Act would provide for the, it would give the specifics of the Act in the Act itself. But the preamble is used in case there's some ambiguity. They can go to the preamble and understand what is the intention of the legislation, which is why it's come into force, and then decide the course of action. But the preamble will not in any way override the plain provisions of the Act. It does not override the plain provisions. It provides the intention. It's an aid, but it will not override the plain provisions of the Act. The plain provisions of the Act will prevail. Then what is an Act? You've been listening about what an Act is everywhere. Income Tax Act, Companies Act. Act is basically a law which has been passed, which has been approved by the Parliament of India, and which has received its assent from the President of India. Till the time the Act is, till the time a bill is not an Act or a law is not an Act, it does not come into force. Then our definitions is something which you will find in section 2 of every act, almost every act. It will give you the definitions of the words which are used in the act. And if there's any ambiguity when you're reading the act, then you can always refer to the definition and understand what the act is trying to tell you. In some of the cases, it's mentioned in section 3 or section 4 of the act. That is the only meaning of the definitions. So pretty simple, can be asked in exams. Then you have means and includes. So what is the difference between means and what's means and includes? So if you see, some definitions would say this means this and this includes this. So when they say means, it's a exhaustive definition and it exactly defines the term. So it says, if it says a company means a company incorporated under this act or any previous law, it means that the company has only one definition, that a company which has been incorporated under Companies Act 2013 or any previous law, in this case would be the 1956 Act. So it does not include anything else except for a company which has been formed under the Companies Act 2013. But when they use the word include, it's an inclusive definition. They give a few words which will give you the meaning of the definition, but it can include other things which are not given in the definition. So it's an inclusive definition and does not define the word exactly, and it is not restricted to the meaning assigned, but has an exhaustive meaning. A body corporate, for example, has been defined to include a company incorporated outside India. It says it includes a company, so a company incorporated outside India will be called a body corporate, but then it can include other things also, including a company incorporated in India. So that's the definition. That's the difference between means and includes, and that definition has been asked in May 19 exam. It's pretty simple. It's something you can answer and you can score marks for. Then similarly for shall and may is basic English. Shall is a mandatory provision. Whenever shall is used, it is something you have to do. When may is used, it's not a mandatory provision. Pretty simple English. There's a case law in that regard. It's a Supreme Court case law. Nice to remember if you can remember. Then we go to the definitions. So now there are a lot of definitions. Some of the definitions have been asked in the MCQs. So it's good to just go through the definitions, because if you just go through it, it won't take much time. And if there's an MCQ in regards to a definition, it's pretty easy to answer. The first definition I'll be covering is affidavit. The only reason for covering the definition is that the definition for affidavit, oath and swear, all three is the same. So you are studying just one definition for three terms, and it's easy to answer if any of the three are asked. It's basically giving an affirmation or declaration instead of swearing, and can be used as an evidence in the court of law. Then you can go through the other definitions, which are quite simple. commencement is the date on which the act will actually come into force. Then you have the financial year and the calendar year. So the year has been defined as per the British calendar. The British calendar says that a year would be a calendar year. So calendar year is Jan to December. A financial year is April to March. For our terms, like for income tax and stuff, the financial year is always relevant. Again, this has been asked somewhere as an MCQ and it's pretty easy to answer. Good faith. Again, it's basically doing things which is in fact, a thing is deemed to be done in good faith where it is in fact done honestly, whether or not it is done negligently. Now, there's a Supreme Court case law in this regard, Mong Ong versus Mong Si Pong. And it says that a good faith, so it's basically regarding good faith defined under the Indian Contract Act, but because it's not defined in the Indian Contract Act, and the definition which is given in the General Clauses Act is pretty vague. It says that nothing is said to be done in good faith which is done without due care and attention as is expected with a man of ordinary prudence. So it has to be done with due care and something which a man in ordinary prudence would do. Again, this has been asked in MTP and it's a simple definition, can be answered, very generic answer to the question, and should go through this before the exam. Immovable property is a very, very important definition. It has been asked multiple times. It's been asked as case study. It has been asked as a subjective question. So it is something that you should do it because it's pretty simple. Immovable property includes, you'll see the word includes. So it includes these four things and it may include something else which is not defined here. It's an inclusive definition. It includes land, benefits to arise out of land, things attached to the earth, or things permanently fastened to anything attached to the earth. Basically, it's very simple to understand that immovable property, something which you cannot move from here to there, it's attached to the earth, or anything which has been a thing permanently fastened to something that has been attached to the earth. I've given some examples here which has been asked and I've tried to cover almost all of them. So tree basically is a movable property. You can't move tree from here to there. Timber, however, is a movable property because that can be moved from here to there. But if you see standing crops, it's again immovable property, cannot be moved. Building, immovable property, pretty common sense. And right of way to access from one place to another. Now the right of way to access from one place to another may be considered as an immovable property, but the right to drain water is not immovable property. Again, machinery fixed to soil is immovable property because it is thing attached to the earth. If you see, it's been asked up in the exam, it's covered in the MTP, RTP, and whatever is immovable, not immovable property, is movable property. So that is the definition of movable property, which you'll see further. Anything that is not immovable property is movable property. So if you're ever asked the definition, you should, if it's a question which has more marks, like 4-5 marks, then you should always give the definition of immovable property when you're writing what's movable property. Then oath, again I said, is the same definition, oath, affidavit and swear. So basically these are the definitions that are covered. These are definitions which used in any other act, if they are not defined specifically in that act, they will derive their meaning from the General Clauses Act. So these definitions are important. If that particular act defines a word which is defined in the General Clauses Act, then you will always refer to the definition given in that particular act and not to the General Clauses Act. Now we'll go to the general rules of construction. That is from section 5 to section 13. The first is coming into operation of an enactment. So when there is an enactment, when is it said that the act comes into force? So there are two things to be seen here. The act will either come into force on the date which has been specified in the act. So section 1 of the act says that this act will come into force on this date. Or the date on which it receives the assent of the President of India. If you are looking at any act which is before the commencement of the Constitution, then it will be the act which receives the assent of the Governor General of India. So basically, you will have to see whether the act has been, act specifies the date on which it will come into force, or if there is no specific date given, the date on which it receives the assent of the President of India. So now, just to give you a simple example, the Companies Act has received the assent of the President of India on 29th of August. However, Section 1 of the Companies Act says that the Act will be notified, was notified in the Official Gazette on 30th of August with enforcement on 30th of August. So here, because the Act provides the date on which it will come into force, the date of enactment would be 30th of August 2013. Similarly, for SEBI also there's something similar. The date on which it's notified, or the date on which it is, which is mentioned in the... Now, effect of repeal is again a very, very important section, and which is something you should remember. You should study this section before going for the exam, because there's a very high probability that this may be asked. So a repeal basically is when an act has been removed completely, and you know there's a Supreme Court judgment which says that it has to be considered as if it had never existed. So the objective of repeal is to obliterate the act, is to remove it completely. Now, when there is a, what are the effects of repeal? And this has been asked quite often. So something which is very important. When there is a repeal, it will not revive anything that is not enforced. It will not affect anything which is, affect any prior management of any legislation. It will not affect any claim, privilege, responsibility or debt obtained. It will not affect any forfeiture, punishment or penalty sustained. And it will not affect any inquiry, litigation or remedy with regards to such claim. So now, basically if there is an act, it has been repealed. But if you have done something, if you have formed, say you have appointed a director under the act, or if you have... pending litigation under the act, or if there was a litigation already done and the order passed by the court that someone's going to be sentenced to 7 years of imprisonment, these things can't be reversed. It will stay as if it was there always. So for example, if someone has been imprisoned for 7 years under a particular act, then after 3 years, if the act is repealed, does not mean that the police officer will say, okay, you can go home today because the act is repealed. He will complete his 7 years. Or if it says that, 7 years imprisonment, but the new act says you will be liable to 10 years of imprisonment, does not mean that his imprisonment will be extended to 10 years. So it cannot affect any claim, not affect any punishment, not affect any inquiry or litigation. It will not affect any prior management, or it will not revive anything not enforced. A very good example of effect of repeal is the Companies Act 1956, which was repealed. So generally, if you repeal any act, and if you have to reinforce the act, then you have to have a valid reason. But Companies Act 1956 was repealed, and we have the Companies Act 2013 now in place. So that is one example of repeal which you can give. Narendra Modi ji has repealed a lot of acts, and some of them are not again coming back like the Companies Act 2013. Now, again, in this, there is a judgment wherein the court has laid down a difference between repeal and deletion. This has been asked in the November 18 exam as to what is the difference between repeal and deletion. When there is a repeal, there is a complete obliteration of the provisions, and it you consider as if it never existed. When it's deletion, it is not complete obliteration, it is deletion from this date. Pehle ka hai, wo hai, but from this date, this has been deleted, so abhi se it will not be applicable. So there's a difference between repeal and deletion, which is quite important, which can be asked in the exam. Here in repeal, it will affect all the inherent rights, all causes of actions related to the repeal provision will never totally affect or wipe out any provision. Cool. I hope this is pretty easy to understand, and something which you should do is difference between repeal and deletion. Now, if there is revival of repealed act, then you need some... a purpose to revive the repealed act. Sometimes they don't get revived, sometimes they do get revived, depending on which act is deleted and what is the reason for repealing of the act. Now, construction of references to repealed enactments. So there are the sometimes when you are looking at definitions or when you are looking at a particular enactment, you will see that there is a reference to another act or some definition which has been defined in this section of this act, which is considered as will be considered for a particular act. To give you a very simple example is section 115 JB of the Income Tax Act, where book profits are calculated. It says that you have to refer to the Companies Act 1956 for calculation of book profits. Now the Companies Act 1956 has been repealed, so there's nothing changing in the Income Tax Act to say Companies Act 2013, but whenever the act is repealed and a new act comes into place, then the book profit will be calculated as per the new act. So when there's a reference made to the repealed act and then it's revived, like there's another act which comes into place, then the reference would be made to that particular act. Now, commencement and termination of time. Sometimes when you there are some provisions in certain sections which gives you that you will be doing a particular thing from this date to this date, or for the purpose of calculating something you will have to consider from this date to this date. I have taken an example of declaration of dividend because this has been asked quite frequently in examinations, and this can be asked as a case study, so it's pretty simple to understand, and you can just answer the questions based on this example. So it says if a company declares dividend in its AGM on 30th of September 18, it is required to pay dividend within 30 days from the date of declaration. So this act basically says that when you have to calculate the number of days, so when you're calculating the from days to 2 days, you will exclude the first day and you will include the last day in the calculation. So in this case, your period of calculation will start from 1st of October to 30th of October 2018. So first in the series of days, that is 30th of September, is excluded, and the last in the series of days, that is 30th of October, will be included. So basically it just says that exclude the first in the series of days to use the word from, and include the last in the series of days to use the words to. This is again very generic, like if you're doing your articleship, you will know that, you know, this is something which you will do daily, but you don't know from where this comes. So it comes from the General Clauses Act. Then you have the computation of time. So sometimes when a thing has to be done, the due date falls on a date which is not a working day, which is a Sunday. So if you have to deposit, say, tax, or you have to, you know, file a return, then if it falls on a day which is not a working day, which is a public holiday, then the next working day will be considered as the due date for filing of return, a payment of tax, whatever it is. So the last day of the prescribed period will be considered into, if the office is closed on that day or the last day, then the next working day, the next day afterwards on which the court or office is open, will be considered. There's again a case in this regard. It's a Madras High Court decision. Then the duty has to be taken pro rata. So sometimes when the duties are given, it say, for example, says that duty or the tax would be rupees 50 for 100 grams of good. Now if you have 98 grams, you don't pay 50, you pay the pro rata duty. That is a quite a, you know, a basic understanding which you would generally do, but that comes from the General Clauses Act. Genders and numbers is something which I have discussed while starting the lecture. It reference to male would include reference to female. Similarly, words in singular shall include plural and vice versa. Now we'll go to provisions as to order, rules, etc., which are made under the enactment. The orders and the rules and the bylaws which are made under the enactment. So that will be covered in section 20 to section. So section 21 says that when there is a power to issue, amend, vary or rescind any notification. So basically, if the legislation gives a power to a particular authority to make a legislation, it is implied that it is giving a power to add, amend, vary or rescind any notification, order, rules or bylaws so issued. So there's again a Supreme Court case in that regard, that there's undoubtedly power to rescind or modify the notification if you have a power to issue the notification. And the power is not restricted to be exercised only once. You can exercise it again and again from time to time. So you can issue notifications how many ever times you want to, because you have the power to make the notification. So you can amend it, you can issue the notifications again and again. Now, another important question is the making of the bylaws, provisions applicable to making of rules or bylaws. Now, this is again asked in exam, a very theoretical question and simple steps which has to be followed and which is given, which are given here. I've just highlighted on the left hand side as to what are the points which you will have to consider. So the first thing before making any rules or bylaws is to publish a proposed draft of the rules or bylaws. So you will have to first publish a draft, and so that every person who is going to be affected by the rules or the bylaws should know that, you know, this is going to be coming into place. Now it has to be issued in the prescribed manner. So the act prescribes a manner in which the rules and bylaws will be issued, and it has to be in that particular manner only. There should be a notice annexed to it saying the date on or after which the draft will come into force. Now if any rule or bylaws requires any approval or any sanction from any authority, any other authority, then that shall also be considered, and shall also be considered any objections or suggestions received with respect to the draft before the date so specified. So the other authority will also have to consider the objections received to the draft. And once the draft it has to be published in the Official Gazette of India to be approved and to be called a rule or a bylaw. Pretty simple. You can answer this question. It's mostly a theoretical type of question, and you should be answering it. Now we'll come to the miscellaneous provision, section 25 to section 30. This again has been asked in RTP. When a act or an offence which you've done is punishable under the two acts, you will not be punished under both the acts. You will be punished under either one of the acts. So that is what has been mentioned in section 26 of the act, that you will be prosecuted and punished under any one of those, but not be punished twice for the same offense. Meaning of service by post. This is a very, very important thing, because if you see, it's been kind of covered at a lot of places. So when a document has to be served by post, you will have to ensure it will be deemed to be affected if there is proper addressing, prepaying and posting by registered post. And when will that be said to be received? The date on which it is actually delivered, it will be said that it has been received by the person. Now there is a case in this regard which says that a document had to be sent by registered post, acknowledgement due, but it was sent by registered post. So whether it's a valid note, it's a valid intimation? No, it's not a valid intimation. Again, this has been asked as question in the exam papers. So if it has to be sent by registered post, acknowledgement due, you have to send it by registered post, acknowledgement due, and not by any other way. Again, if a notice has been sent and it has been returned or it has been rejected, it will deem to have been served because it has, you know, the person has received it. Again, there is a Supreme Court case in this regard that if there is any endorsement or refusal, it will be presumed that the notice has been served. Yeah, if it has been sent to concerned person at the proper address, it is served in due course unless the contrary is proved. Endorsement not claimed, not made is sufficient to prove deemed service of notice. So basically when the service, the notice has been gone but the person at the opposite end is either not receiving it, endorsing it or he is not there, does not mean that the notice has not been served. He was not there to take it. And citation of enactments is a basic. So basically this is the General Clauses Act. It is very, very simple. Just go through the video, go through the notes. I am attaching these notes along with this video. I will also be attaching all the list of questions which have been asked in the past papers which are covered in the RTP and the MTP. So I would request you to just spend like one and a half hour of your time, and trust me, it is worth that 10 marks because it's not something rocket science. The questions are not twisted. The case studies are not at all twisted. Pretty simple, easy to answer. And if you have any doubts, my number is here given below. You can always call me up.